Hello and welcome. My name is Vladimir Herd. I'm a senior researcher at the University of Bremen and at the German Research Center for Artificial Intelligence. My talk is about RISC-V compliance testing and in particular using coverage-guided fuzzing to boost the RISC-V compliance testing process by focusing on negative testing. My talk will be structured as follows. I start with an overview and informal definition on RISC-V compliance testing and the involved challenges. Then I will present our contribution to improve compliance testing by using fuzzing-based techniques that focus on negative testing. I will also show our experimental results where we found bugs in several RISC-V simulators. Finally, I will conclude my talk with a short wrap-up. What is compliance testing and why is it important? Compliance testing basically shows that a processor or instruction set simulator adheres to the ISA specification. This sounds very much like verification, and there certainly is an overlap between these two, but compliance testing is not formal verification. The goal of formal verification is to show or to prove that an implementation works correctly under all possible inputs. The goal of compliance testing essentially is to show that an implementation is compatible with the RISC-V ecosystem. So what does compliance actually check? It checks, for example, that all registers are available that should be there. It checks their widths, it checks that different access combinations of registers work correctly, and it also, for example, checks that sign extensions work correctly as well. In addition, it also checks that all instructions that should be there by the instruction set are really there, and this includes also basic sanity checks. For example, that an add instruction really performs an addition and not a subtraction. One more important check is that no additional behavior is accidentally added. This is also very important in the RISC-V context because RISC-V is designed in a very modular way, which enables a lot of flexibility in building different configurations. So this makes it very possible that some additional behavior is accidentally added. The overall main goal of compliance testing is to ensure compatibility with the RISC-V software ecosystem. This is what Alan Baum, the chair of the RISC-V compliance task group, has said about the challenge of RISC-V compliance. RISC-V is an open source standard ISA with exceptional modularity and extensibility. Anyone can build an implementation and there are no license fees. Implementers are free to add custom extensions to boost capabilities and performance, while at the same time don't have to include features that aren't needed. And this has several implications. First, an increasingly large number of customized RISC-V cores is being implemented. And in addition, this unconstrained flexibility, it greatly increases the risk of introducing incompatibilities between those implementations and the RISC-V software ecosystem. So compliance testing becomes very important, but it is also very challenging. Right now, it is still not fully clear what the best way is to solve the RISC-V compliance testing problem. The current official solution is to build a compliance test suite for RISC-V ISA parts separately. So how does compliance testing now look like? It starts with a compliance test suite, which is executed on a reference simulator to produce reference outputs. These reference outputs essentially are signatures, which are produced for every executed test case and essentially include a dump of a specific result memory region. Then the compliance test suite is executed on the core or simulator, which is under test to produce test outputs, which are then compared against the pre-computed reference outputs. In general, this approach works quite well, but there are still some problems that need to be addressed. For one thing, significant effort is involved in producing the test suites. In addition, it is also very difficult to achieve a high coverage. And negative testing is mostly neglected. On a technical side, compliance tests are provided in a platform-independent assembly format, which are then compiled to the specific target platform. To improve the RISC-V compliance testing process, we developed several approaches which I want to briefly introduce on this slide. The first is specification-based, where coverage requirements for the final test suite are specified in combination with instruction constraints in a domain-specific language. All requirements are solved in combination with the constraints using an SMT solver to generate a compliance test suite. It focuses on positive testing and has been effective in increasing coverage. Our second approach complements the first one by utilizing mutation-based testing. Based on a set of mutation classes tailored for RISC-V, symbolic execution techniques are leveraged to generate a test suite that kills all mutations in the ISS. In our third approach, the focus is on negative testing to complement the other approaches. It attempts to reveal bugs by focusing on illegal instructions and other inputs that can cause exceptions. The rationale is to ensure that no additional behavior is accidentally added in a RISC-V implementation. Here we leverage fuzzing-based techniques that are guided by coverage. In the following, I will focus on this technique and provide more details. So our approach is using fuzzing-based techniques to generate a compliance test suite in an automated way with strong negative testing capabilities. This is the very high-level overview on our approach, and now I will present you more details on the fuzzing-based generation. Technically, we use coverage-guided fuzzing here. It works by generating new inputs, which from the fuzzer perspective are plain byte streams, and in this context are simply interpreted as RISC-V instructions. Each such input is executed on a RISC-V simulator, which is used to drive the test generation process. The simulator collects and reports execution coverage information back to the fuzzer. And the fuzzer, in turn, is using the coverage to select new inputs, mutate the inputs, and then send them to the simulator again. This overall generation process results in a coverage-guided loop, and the fuzzer collects all inputs that increase the coverage. In addition to the fuzzer and simulator, we provide a test template written in assembly, which is compatible with the compliance testing format. And this test template is responsible to set up a test execution and shut down the test execution again. This test template is compiled into a binary version of the template and then preloaded into the memory of the simulator. This makes the test execution process very efficient because new input instructions, which are generated by the fuzzer, can directly be embedded into this test template in memory without any additional compiler calls. To produce the final compliance test suite, we combine every of the generated inputs with the test template. Technically, we use the LLVM-based libfuzzer for the fuzzing process. And in addition, we integrate custom mutators to generate new inputs more efficiently. And beside code coverage, we also use custom coverage metrics inside of the simulator to guide the fuzzing process. And one final and very important ingredient of our approach is a filter, which is placed between the fuzzer and simulator to remove specific inputs, and in particular those inputs which may contain platform-dependent details and are therefore not compatible with compliance testing. And by using the filter, our approach works in an automated way without requiring user interaction to decide if maybe a spurious mismatch occurred due to platform-dependent test cases. On this slide, I want to provide some more information on the filter, which is important to ensure that no platform-dependent instructions are used. It essentially ensures that no hard-coded addresses are used for memory access operations or jumps. The reason is that the memory layout is platform-dependent and thus can be different between simulators. Therefore, only relative jumps should be used or labels employed to ensure that jumps and memory accesses are valid. Another source of instructions that is dropped by the filter are, for example, CSR instructions, since they often allow different legal implementations and thus cannot be matched by compliance test signatures. And the filter also ensures that no infinite loops are generated, since they would cause non-termination of the test case execution. Therefore, the filter employs a conservative static analysis on the fuzzer generated instruction stream. Essentially, the analysis enumerates all possible static paths through the instruction stream and checks that all reachable instructions are valid and no infinite loop is entered. Finally, negative testing capabilities are not compromised by the filter, as no illegal instructions are dropped because the semantic is clearly defined without platform-dependent details. Now, when we look at the fuzzing process itself, fuzzing essentially uses randomization without domain-specific knowledge. However, it makes sense to basically teach the fuzzer information on the RISC-V instruction format. Here you can see the format of different RISC-V instruction types, which includes the opcode and coding of source and destination registers, as well as immediate values. Essentially, we therefore provide a custom mutator to inject special values and instructions into the fuzzing process. The fuzzer can then also reuse this pattern to build longer sequences of valid instructions. As an example, we provide a custom mutator to inject a random opcode into the input stream. By doing so, we obtain a valid instruction, but with randomized fields, such as the source and destination registers or immediate values. So, starting with a randomized byte stream from the fuzzer, the mutator moves from the left to the right, instruction by instruction. It starts at the beginning of the byte stream, and now let's assume that an @e opcode is injected. The byte stream is mutated to include the @e opcode, but retains the randomization in the other fields. The inject position is moved forward accordingly to point to the beginning of the next instruction. At this point, another mutation can be applied. Beside the mutation that injects an opcode, we also consider other mutators, such as injecting an instruction sequence in order to load large immediate values into registers, which requires more than one RISC-V instruction due to the immediate encoding. This custom mutator is chosen with the same probability as the built-in libfuzzer mutators. It is also a non-intrusive fuzzer extension, as libfuzzer provides a designated interface for this use case. The second extension for the fuzzing process that we consider is a custom coverage metric. By default, coverage-guided fuzzing is guided by code coverage and in particular branch coverage. So it will basically cover and distinguish between the different instruction cases in the instruction set simulate. But again, it can make sense to make this coverage metric stronger. Because when you look more closely at instructions, there are different fields beside the opcode, which are also important to consider. For example, it can make sense to distinguish between the destination register access combinations. We achieve these by means of functional coverage. So we distinguish different register access combinations, such as the destination register being zero or not zero, which is a special case in RISC-V because the zero register is hard-coded. Another case is that the source and destination register are equal or different. This case applies for instructions with a single or also with two source registers. We also consider different special values for immediates and inside of registers. On a technical side, functional coverage is encoded by mapping it to code coverage by means of artificial branches. The required information is obtained by adding an execution observer to the instruction stream set simulator that is notified before and after executing an instruction. So now we have a coverage-guided fuzzing loop for instruction stream generation that is boosted with custom mutators and custom coverage metrics to improve and guide the generation process, as well as a filter to avoid generation of platform-dependent tests. In the following, I will present our experimental setup and the obtained results. As foundation for the fuzzing process, we use our own open source RISC-V virtual prototype and in particular the instruction set simulator of our VP. Meanwhile, we provide a 32 and 64-bit ISS with all RISC-V standard instruction set extensions and support for supervisor and user-level privilege modes, as well as interrupt handling. Our VP is implemented in C++ using the systemc library with TLM 2.0 and at this point has roughly 25,000 lines of code, including all features. Our VP and thus also the ISS that we used for the fuzzing process is fully open source and available under the MIT license. You can find more information on the VP platform at the given link systemc-verification.org/RISC-V-VP. Features of our VP include, for example, software debugging support using the Eclipse IDE by implementing the GDB interface, support for several operating systems such as FreeRTOS, Sapphire, Riot, and also Linux. And we also provide an example VP configuration for the Hi-5 One board from Sci-5. The actual experiments we have executed on a Linux system with a standard laptop that is using an Intel processor with 2.5 GHz. As I said before, we used our ISS from the open source VP as foundation for the fuzzing process and libfuzzer as the actual fuzzer. We set a runtime limit of 30 minutes for the test generation process. We observed around 45,000 executions per second, which include generating the test input, executing the input on the ISS, and returning back coverage information to the fuzzer. In total, 1 GB of memory was consumed or reserved at the peak. As a result, around 30,500 test cases have been generated, which we used for the subsequent testing process. As reference simulator, we used RISC-V OVP-SIM from Imperos, which is a highly configurable simulator that provides comprehensive support for RISC-V and is used as reference simulator for compliance testing. This table summarizes our evaluation results. We considered 4 RISC-V simulators, including Spike, our ISS, Sail, and Grift. In addition, we used 3 different RISC-V ISA configurations, namely the base integer ISA, with M and C extensions, and with all standard extensions. The table reports the number of mismatches we observed against RISC-V OVP-SIM. As a result, we found bugs in several RISC-V simulators. So in summary, I have presented our approach for RISC-V compliance testing that puts a strong emphasis on negative testing to complement the existing compliance testing solutions for RISC-V. On a technical side, we leverage coverage-guided fuzzing techniques for the test generation process. The fuzzing procedure is tailored for the RISC-V ISA and integrates custom mutation operations and coverage metrics to guide the test generation process more effectively. A special filter is integrated to avoid the generation of platform-dependent test cases that, for example, depend on hard-coded memory access addresses or jump targets. We obtained very promising experimental results in finding bugs in several RISC-V simulators. You can find more and related information, as well as most recent updates on this and our other RISC-V related approaches at systemc-verification.org/RISC-V.